What are some of the challenges, if you like, of filming everything in 3D? And is it, I was watching, there's a certain stately quality to a lot of the camera work, I notice. Quite long tracking shots, things like that. Is that the key to a certain way of filming it?
Yes, and the general unwieldiness of the camera, which has got better and better since we started. When we started on Flying Monsters, which was how long ago?
4 years ago.
4 years ago. We had a crew of 16, you know. And the camera was a great unwieldy beast, and it was very bad tempered and needed pampering and looking after and, you know, forever. And I remember the first shot we did was actually on location in Germany. And I remember Anthony looking around and seeing this vast army of people all standing around, you know, over the crew, and looking at the rain coming, and I think we did two shots.
We did two shots
that first day, and the cost per shot, I mean, astronomical.
We were limited when we could obviously film, so we did a big stint in the middle of 15 nights flat out. And David's really the main person in the film, you know, the only person in the film apart from a few extras. And David had to get up in the middle of the night, you know, and just perform. We spent hours setting up the sequence. Dan and his team had spent hours setting it up. And also, acting to nothing is pretty damn hard, you know. You ask Harrison Ford or anyone else in Star Wars, and you know, it's a very, very hard thing to do.
I'll tell you, I don't want to be unduly complicated or philosophical about it, but the really difficult thing was that I spent my career in broadcasting, trying to tell the truth as it is. If I said I could see a lion inventing it, there was a lion. And so the awkward thing was, how do you react when there is a computer-generated images, when anybody with any savvy knows that it's that you're, as it were, telling a lie? It did worry me, and I decided that the only way to do it was to do it in such a way that the audience would know immediately that it couldn't be actuality.
Right.
They would know immediately, and that they would know that you knew it wasn't, and that therefore it was a kind of there was a complicity between the audience and yourself in you know on what basis you were doing things.
I mean, I think the problem with this one was, as has been with all the 3D films, that we're pushing the boat out a bit. We're really trying to innovate. And we always end up in this situation of too little time, but we always end up in the situation of actually not having the software and hardware, because we're really pushing, you know, on 4K and in 3D to actually finish the film. And we always finish it about 2 hours before it broadcasts. Yes. You know,
so it really did. I had heart failure. Yeah. I said, I mean, I saw it at some stage, like sort of 48 hours before we had to go on. And I said, but then we were going to alter that. Don't worry. We'll work all bloody night and it'll be all right.
And what about, from a technical point of view, I mean, you made 3D programs together, and but this building seems like, I mean, it's a wonderful place. You walk in, and the way it's lit, and it looks magnificent. To capture that, was that hard? The lighting of it and the size of it.
Yes, Tim Cragg is an absolutely sort of top lighting guy there, and understands lighting for 3D very well. And it was also part of the thing that when I was thinking of the idea to start with, you thought, a box-shaped space with limits on either side is exactly what you need if you really want to register 3D.
Yeah, and it's interesting because I think it's right that today Gravity was nominated for all those BAFTAs and is considered a British film, which a lot of people can understand, but the reason it is because it's got British technicians, British people, and a lot of people worked on this show, is that right?
We had him first. We did.
Yeah. I mean, that's the nice thing. I mean, in a way, documentaries have been more of an incubation for experimenting with 3D, almost the movies, because everything is made up of it. You don't have lots of talking heads, effectively. And so what's nice is the team has seamlessly crossed over from working with us on Flying Monsters, working with us on Galapagos and the other five films, this is our sixth together, and then coming back to work with us on that. It is British talent. I mean, of course, there are other people involved, but it is a huge pool of Britain, and we are really leaders in the world in this area.
You know? Well, I was going to say, because to me, a lot of critics looking at films, dramatic films, are critical of 3D. That, you know, that you can be for or against it, but this feels like what it's made for to me. Did it feel like the way to you that this is a way of using that technology?
Yeah, but I hope so. I mean, I hope that the 3D really did add something. At the same time, you know, I was around when we were introducing colour television for the first time, in this country, and I remember going and exhorting producers and saying, "Look, don't fall into the gap and into the heresy of thinking that just because it's in colour, it's okay." You know, a comedian who's wearing, if it's a bad comedian and you put him in a tartan skirt or a kilt, I mean, he's still just as unfunny. You know?
Absolutely.
So don't think that you can make a program that's going to be dull in black and white, but okay in 3D.
No, I mean, it's totally story. I mean, the other complication for us is that we're shooting for television, we're shooting in IMAX, all of these films go to IMAX and have done pretty well as IMAXs. And you know, and they have to work in 2D too. And you know, I'm glad to say I think it got one of the highest audiences in factual programming on Sky. So we're juggling all these balls. But I think David and I are making these films, and we went to Sky to make these films in 3D. Mm. And so they've got to have impact in 3D and big impact. And we're the lucky thing is Sky's also invested in us to kind of make mistakes if we need to. So on the way, we're sometimes going down blind alleys. And I think this one, we couldn't possibly have made this one if we hadn't made the other five.
Sure.
I think
no, that's true. That's
is this, it strikes me that as time goes on, you're not slowing down in terms of making TV shows, and it almost feels like you're doing even more prolific than ever. Asprey, is it partly the technology, this kind of thing that's enabling you to do new things?
Or it's fun. Yeah. You know? I mean, making if it wasn't funny, I wouldn't be doing it. I mean, that's how I started, because it was fun, and it's been fun ever since. So I just have a great time with a lot of pals, you know? Yeah. And you have a great time, and solving these problems, and sitting with a beer in the evening and thinking we could do it this way or that way. It's great fun. It's huge fun.
And it's a huge team effort. I mean, let me say, David would know this. We were days when we went what do we call breakfast, but breakfast was really dinner because we dislocated our days and worked 7 to 7. And you know, we looked around and there were literally nearly 100 people in the museum. And there's a huge craft involved in these films. I mean, there's CGI, there's art department. I mean, it really is a massive team. And you know, the nice thing is we've managed to nurture talent. And on this one, we took some risks. We used people and brought them to the forefront because we wanted to do something different. And there's, you know, I think there's a lot of ideas in this film, and that's what I like about it. You know, it's a simple premise. There's lots of ideas going on, and that's what was great. You know.
And when you see the finished version, it must be an extraordinary difference between making something like this and various other, you know, a regular natural history show. How does it feel when you sit and watch this in a cinema in 3D?
Something that should be said. The core of the work is done actually in Hammersmith in Atlantic's office in Zoo, and which is the name of the unit, the 3D CGI unit, of which there are, if you walk in, you would see 20 people, right? And it's in the man who's running it is a very quiet spoken chap called James Prosser. The first thing we did, the first time we worked with James, wasn't in 3D, but it was CGI, and it was about some very early fossils. I was absolutely blown away because I'd seen CGI fossils and so on, but these were in a different order. And it was, I puzzled as to why they were so good. And it was something to do with the texture, but it was also something almost uncanny that the animal actually did, which was almost unpredictable, a little twitch or a little movement or something, which somehow was true, that this was a real thing, it was a real living animal. And it was sometimes I thought somewhere there's some guy here, you know, who really understands about animals. And it was James. I discovered, I said to him one day, I said, "James, how did you come by this?" Well, he said, in a sort of modest, matter of fact way, he said, "Well, as a matter of fact, I started off as a vertebrate paleontologist." I said, "What?" He said, "Yes, and I got into this, and I quite enjoyed this, and so on." But he was, as a student, as an undergraduate, he studied fossil vertebrates.
With the emerging technologies that are coming out every day, there are now the opportunities to almost rediscover some of the great theories and discoveries that have been in existence for centuries now. And there's a couple of examples in the film where you sort of play with that. I wonder if you might want to expand on that a bit.
Only that that we are working hand in glove with experts on particular genera or particular species, not only in London. I mean, London itself, the Natural History Museum, has a great concentration of such people, but we're able to do so around the world because we live in the electronic age. And James would put on a CGI of something and send it overnight to the world's greatest expert on moas who happens to live in New Zealand. And when James would come in the following morning, there would be an answer for him, say, no, I think it wouldn't have moved quite as faster, or whatever, and you were able to change it. But the scientists themselves loved the business. I mean, they were actually being pinned down. Now, do you really mean to say it moved that way? Because doesn't that look a bit unnatural to you? And so it was, the process was a joint process of discovery. And I think that certainly those paleontologists I know enjoyed doing it, because not simply because it was a game, but because it helped them focus their ideas and made it concrete to the certain things that they said. So it was certainly a delight from both points of view, both from ours as filmmakers and theirs as paleontologists.
It amazes me that you don't... I don't know what I would want to be shooting. It's like, did you storyboard sequence?
That's a very good question. Every single film we've done with 3D, because you've got, you know, even though you've got more money often because it's 3D, you've got, you know, scarcity of time and shots. With this film, Dan, once David had delivered the script and we'd gone through it in detail with David, Dan storyboarded every single shot. That didn't mean when we got to a shot, we didn't, you know, change it. But if you can imagine the complications of shooting something where you've got David and then you haven't got David, you've got blue screen, you've got creatures, and you've got to hit the spot, because in this size screen, but on an IMAX screen even more, but certainly on this size screen, you can see if it's not absolutely spot on. So there's a huge amount of complexity in the shooting. I mean, you know, wires hanging and gloves in front of David's face to get that to work. But every single detail of this film was minutely planned.
Thank you.
Otherwise, we'd still be shooting.
So I wondered, what did you have to compromise on? Because clearly, you had a deadline. Thank you.
I don't think we did compromise on much. Certainly, every criticism that I had of a sequence or a shot, I mean, we debated. I won't say I just snapped my fingers and said, change it. But every one that we discussed and we agreed ought to be changed was done. And I don't think we compromised on much, really.
I think sometimes you think you're going to, but you don't want to. And we probably did it by working all day and all night. So we doubled up 6 months into, you see what I mean? I mean, we literally did, because we worked with people around the world, specialists around the world. And I think, you know, David's a perfectionist, and so are the team that's working on it. And so it's a very good question. But in the end, there was always those things, oh, well, we won't worry about that. When you get to see it, everything matters in this film, every beat, every, you know, Halo did a fantastic mix for it. Everything matters, I think. And if it didn't, somehow it'd start to fall apart. Does that make sense? It was kind of everything or nothing.
But how is the relationship between yourself, Sir David, as the presenter, and also the production company, and how you come up with that light bulb idea, and specifically with the Natural History Museum, which one of those, or which selection of those 60 million species do you put into your program?
Well, to be absolutely truthful, I mean, it's a subject I know pretty well. You know, I knew the museum fairly well, and I know the big. I mean, this is not rocket science in paleontological terms. I mean, this is fairly simple, straightforward paleontology. So, if I didn't know that, I ought to have known it. Once the notion was there. The problem about it, as far as I was concerned as a scriptwriter, is that if you weren't careful, it was going to become very repetitive. It was going to be, here's a fossil, and now we're going to bring it to life, and the trot about, and then here's another fossil, and now we're going to bring it to life, and the trot about. And so you had to think of something which would make each one of those special and different. And the character of Richard Owen, who is only sketched upon, but he's there hovering in the background, and he is a fascinating Victorian figure. I mean, he was a great opponent of Darwin's, I mean, but nonetheless a great scientist, and in many ways a diabolical man. But he was, he was. I mean, he really dreadful things that he did. But anyway, then writing the script so that each one of those things that came off the wall, that you brought to life, had something different about it that would made it different from everything else. And that was the problem. If I could just add one thing, someone asked about the problems and hampering of 3D. What are the limitations of 3D from a natural history filmmaker? And there is a simply huge, huge limitation in 3D for a natural history filmmaker. And that is, you cannot, for very, very profound optical reasons, scientific reasons, which I could amplify if you wanted, you cannot use long focus lenses. And if you said to a natural history cameraman today, I want you to go and make a real Bobby Dazzler of a natural history film, but you aren't, and somewhere than that about animals, but you're not allowed to use anything more than a 65mm lens, he would think you're crazy. I mean, most of the stuff you see on natural history films is shot with long lenses, because it means you don't have to get close to the animals and they can behave in a natural way. But you cannot use long focus lenses in 3D.
But I've been wanting to ask you this question for about 12 years, because my answer to it, one of my answers to it, is always you. If you had a dinner party, which three people would you have at your table? And they can be animals, they don't have to be humans. Sorry, I've just really wanted to ask you that for so long.
No, I'm glad you asked.
How many people would you, if you had three people at dinner party?
How many
would
people
you,
what?
Would you, who, which three people would you invite to a dinner party?
For a dinner party?
Yeah.
Well, have
I don't
animals.
Know, depend how far gone you are, how many bottles you have. I think if I started with the soup, I'd probably have Charles Darwin, and if I was going to end with the cheese and the port, I'd rather have Groucho Marx.
Anthony and Sir David, thank you very much.
Thank you.